welcome to my podcast. This is Anne P. of Fiber, Floss, and Fiction. Today is Thursday, May 14th, so we are already halfway into May. Hard to believe how fast time is going right now. I hope you are well in your part of the world and that you and your loved ones are staying safe. Here in New Mexico, we are slowly starting to have some services be expanded, so that's been good for the local economy. I know restaurants and other retail type spaces have been really, really struggling right now. So I hope that if you're involved in any of those services where you are, things maybe are starting to get back to normal, but please do continue to stay safe and practice all those good things like hand washing and social distancing and all of that. We are moving into our super dry season before our summer monsoons kick in, and the pollen count is crazy, so I'm a little snuffly today, but nothing too bad, and just staying home doing the new normal. So I'm just going to jump right in today because I don't want this to be a super long video. I've got my usual three topics to talk about. So we'll have knitting, we'll have books, and we'll have cross stitch. If you're a new viewer, welcome. I hope that you enjoy spending some time visiting with me today and have a reason to come back and be a subscriber. And of course, for those of you who have been with me for a while, thank you as always for joining me today, and so welcome back. Let's see. So if you have been hanging out with me for the last month, you know that I have been working on the hashtag the 100 day project, which I have been focusing on working on charity gifts and working through kind of my stash to knit from over the last, I believe we're at day 38, maybe, ish. Started April 7th, officially was the kickoff, so here we are, May 14th, a month and a week, basically. So let me talk to you about what I've been knitting on. The first thing, which I am still working on, but I'm gonna get finished this weekend, is the Campside Shawl by Alicia Plummer. This is actually a free pattern. You can find it if you go to Ravelry. As always, I will link to the patterns below that she did for Pom Pom Magazine, and it's now a freebie. So it's a great DK weight shawl, and I am utilizing a DK yarn that I had received as a gift, which I had three skeins of in my stash, which is going to be just about perfect, I think. It's this gorgeous, not quite navy blue color. That's pretty close. The yarn manufacturer is Alta with two, well, actually three A's, but A-A-L-T-A yarn. And this is their 80-20 wool and alpaca blend DK weight. It is a great yarn. I had not worked with it before, so this was a nice excuse to pull it out of my stash and make something with it. The yarn is soft, but not super, super fuzzy. It has kind of more of a soft wool feel as opposed to an alpaca-y feel, but there's just a little bit of drape to it, so it's, I think, going to be perfect for the end use of this shawl. So I am, if you follow me on Instagram, this is the big blue blob. That's basically what it looks like, is a big blue blob at this point. It's a fairly simple pattern. It's a triangular shawl, which you kind of can't see because it's all scrunched up on my needles. But you start with just this little setup section that's plain stockinette, and then you move into kind of wide-spaced eyelets. And as you work your way down through the design, the eyelets get closer together. So there's like little almost raindrop looks here. And then you finish it off with a ribbing at the bottom. So I am just through the halfway part of the ribbing, and I really would like to get this off the needles this weekend, so hopefully next time that you guys see it, it will look like an actual something and be off the needles, and I will have had that project finished. Like I said, really enjoying working with this yarn. It's super soft. It's a lovely warm layer. I think it's going to be a great giveaway, gift, charity project for someone for the winter months. So looking forward to having that done. Recommend the pattern. It's easy to follow, very straightforward. It's both charted and written if you're somebody who doesn't follow charts. The only thing that I don't care for is there's the transitional rows between the sort of more widely spaced eyelets transitioning to the next type of patterning. I don't love how those are set up, but they're easy to understand. So I'm going with it. I'm not letting my knitting OCD take over there. I'm just enjoying that process. So look for that to hopefully be finished up next time I see you. I do have another shawl that I'm pretty sure is what's going to get cast on next, but when I finish this bigger project, I am going to pop into a quick and easy hat, DK weight hat, and I have earmarked Helen Stewart's How Quiet hat. She's Curious Handmade on Ravelry and social media. This was from her Advent collection from, I don't think it was last year, but the year before, so maybe 2018? I will link to it on Ravelry as well. So both the hat and the mitts are in the Advent group set, but you can also get them separately. And I'm just going to be doing the hat because I have one skein of this pretty rosy tweed from Rowan Yarns. This is their Yorkshire Tweed DK. I knit a sweater out of this. I've knit a couple of other things out of this. This is the last skein I have lingering in my stash, and it is almost perfect for the amount of yardage I need for this project. So I thought that would be a very pretty, just basic hat. It's ribbed with kind of a textured chevron pattern in here. So that's gonna be the next thing that I cast on for the 100-day project. I've also been working on some shop type samples. I have one pattern that will be releasing for the end of the month, technically June 1st, but I'll have that to show you for the next time I record my podcast in about another week. It's a fingering weight lace shawl that's part of the Ohm alphabet, the tree-themed alphabet project that I've been working on for several years for the Yarn Guys. So look for that. That one's coming up, and I will have that sample to share with you next time. So let's go on, and we're going to talk about books. I have three books to share with you guys this week. Let's see. The first one that I finished up, we'll talk about fairly quickly, is a collection of short stories called Mythic Journeys, edited by Paula Guran, I think is how she says her last name. All of my books that I talk about, I will link down below to the Goodreads page so you can find them in case you have interest in them. So Mythic Journeys is a collection of short stories by various and sundry authors that are all themed on it's billed as being themed on some fairy tales, but it's really just focused on myths. The nice thing about this collection is that it talks about myths from all kinds of different cultures. A lot of times they just focus on, like, let's say, the Greek and Roman sort of classic myths, and there are those in there, but they also have some from other Aboriginal type tribes in Africa and Australia, as well as a couple Native American ones as well. So I liked the fact that there was a lot of different cultural heritage in the backgrounds of them. I'm gonna admit that while they do give you kind of 5 or 6 pages at the front of the book that says, you know, this story is in reference to this myth, if I didn't keep referring to that, sometimes I wasn't even sure what myth, even if I knew the myth, that the short story was recreating. So that bothered me a bit because I wanted to be able to have something to compare it to kind of see what the new take was. And I mean, the stories themselves might have been great, but I liked having the hook back to the original myth. And when it wasn't always clear, sometimes that was a little disconcerting for me. As with most short story anthology type collections, I loved some of them. I didn't love some of them. Neil Gaiman and Charles DeLint are both featured in this. Their stories, which are smack dab in the middle of the book, are great. Some of them were just really weird and creepy, and I had a hard time getting into them, so there were a few that I just skimmed. And there were some that were okay, but I probably wouldn't have gravitated towards them if they had been standalones. So, kind of a mixed bag. I do like short stories. I think they're a great way to kind of experience an author in the boiled down essence of how they write and how they develop characters, because they have to say a lot in a little time. But when you have an anthology of them, sometimes the ones you like are mixed in with ones you don't. So, enjoyable read. It was one my dad sent me, so I'm not like out anything. I enjoyed reading it, and I guess I would give it like a B minus. Like I said, a little uneven for me. The next book was an audiobook that I listened to. This is Moonheart by Charles DeLint, and this was actually his very first book that was published. And I thought that I had read this, but as I listened to it, it was not the book I thought I had read. I've read many of his, and I think he has 20 odd some books published now. So this was not one that I had read, but I'm glad that I did, because it is kind of the first book that introduces you to how he presents his characters and the world that they live in. Both this particular one is one of the ones set in Ottawa, as well as in a different realm, a magical realm. And there's actually two timelines in that magical realm that he's working with. He also introduces you to some of the kind of standard characters that show up in later books of his. So Tamsin House, for example, in downtown Ottawa, is a major character in this book, as well as Sarah Kendall, who she lives at Tamsin House, and we see her in later books as a character. And he introduces a lot of the magical realism themes that are carried out through other books of his. So I felt like this was a great place to start. It kind of got me caught back up in terms of how he presents concepts and sucked me back into that world that he's created. It is, however, dated. I'm not sure the publication date of it. I want to say like maybe 1982. But there's a lot of the plot that revolves around things not happening as they do today. So for instance, like none of the police, the detectives that are in this book, have a cell phone. So they always have to like leave a message, or they have to let somebody know to meet them someplace else by calling into the main switchboard. So how the plot develops set in that era, which wasn't really even that long ago if you think about it, versus how I think the plot would be developed today, are very different things, because we've all come to expect, you know, you just open your cell phone and you make a quick call and you can say to someone, here's where I am. There's also some tie-ins to how computers are used to research some of the more arcane topics. And again, we're at a point now where you just use your smartphone if you wanted to know about divination, or if you wanted to learn about oracle bones or something like that. You just open your phone and search for it. And for these characters, they have much less ways of knowing that kind of access to information. So it was kind of an interesting balance in that not only are you reading the book for the story of Moonheart itself, but you're also kind of translating some of it into what was happening at the time that the book is set for contemporary 20th century. So I don't think it's as strong as some of his other works. Not that that's a surprise, right? It was his first book out of the gate. He was tackling a lot of different topics and moving parts and trying to get this world built. So it's not quite as easy a read as some of his other ones, but I enjoyed it. This was an Audible version, so I enjoyed the narrator. Did a good job with it. And I like Dylan's writing enough that I probably would read anything that was of his writing. So a good one if you like Dylan or like magical realism and want to read more. I think I would maybe read some of his other ones first and then pick this one up at the back end, you know, to kind of help build the world a little bit more for you, and maybe not the first one to tackle if you're interested in reading books that he's written. But a recommendation anyway. Then the final book that I read was a historical fiction called A Spear of Summer Grass. The author is Deanna Rayborn, and I can't remember if it was 2 years ago or just a year ago, but I've read other books by this author and enjoyed them. They were historical mystery set in the UK, a good heroine, and I enjoyed those. So I thought, well, okay, this is a different series or different group of characters. I like the author. Let me give it a shot. So the book is set in Australia. It is set in the Roaring Twenties. Our main character is a feisty heroine who is basically kicked out of her family. There's a whole convoluted backstory where she's actually American. Her money is American, but her mother has married various British men, and now lives in London. And our main character is... she's definitely like the hellraiser of the family. She's on her third or fourth husband and is on the verge of being disinherited, and she's basically told to go cool her heels somewhere. And where she goes to cool her heels, and I'm sorry, not Australia, Africa. And I'm not even sure why I said Australia. Africa. She is in Africa. One of her mother's ex-husbands owns an estate. And so this is set kind of in the period of Out of Africa. And I think based on the period setting, the little synopsis that I read, and the cover art, I thought that this was going to be similar to the book I read last year that was about... the character who is in Out of Africa, who's Beryl Markham, who was one of the first women pilots, and she appears as the character of Felicity in the Out of Africa movie, but was based on a real woman who had an amazing life and was very adventurous and kind of embraced all of the things that Africa had to offer with its good and its bads. Okay, so I thought that this book would be like that. This book was not like that. It sort of was a mystery. It sort of was historical fiction. It sort of had some romance in it. I think part of the problem was the book wasn't sure what it wanted to be, and so I was confused by what was going on in the story, in the sense that I was like, is the heroine now solving this mystery? As it kind of turns out, she doesn't really solve it. It just sort of gets resolved. It sort of dumps itself into an ending. there's sort of some tension, you know, will she stay and embrace the land, or will she go back to her highbrow life in London? That kind of peters out. A lot of the sort of adventure parts of the story, where I think you could have really taken the story and done something interesting with it about the assimilation of the British culture into the African landscape, didn't really happen. This was not a horrible book. It was not necessarily bad, but let's just say I'm not going to recommend it. It was a very C effort. It was very uneven, and I think it could have just been so much more if it had had a better focus to it, which was a disappointment. There's, I think, another book in the same series that talks about the same characters and like follows them further in this journey when they're in Africa. But I'm not going to read it, and I'm disappointed because this was an author I thought that would be like a good choice for an entertaining read. So I wound up kind of skimming through it, and let's not put it on your short list. Currently right now, I have a bunch of books on the go. I have an audiobook I'm reading, which I'm enjoying very, very much, which I'll talk about more when I get finished it. And I actually have three books started. One is print, one is a Kindle book that I had just started, and then, of course, because this is how this happens, I had a library loan I had been waiting on come up, and I didn't want to go back to the end of the wait list, so I went ahead and grabbed it, and I'm kind of trying to just focus on that right now. But I have a lot of books on the go, so let me get through and actually finish some of those before we talk about books, which then I'll do for my next podcast with y'all. Okay, so let's go on, and we're going to talk cross stitch now. So we are firmly in the middle of the month of May for Stitch Mania. For those of you who are participating in that, I hope you're enjoying it. My mania plans for this year have focused on working on a whole bunch of WIPs that are on my Stitch 20 in 20 plans for the year. I have gotten quite a bit done. Just the caveat that I actually started my mania a little bit early on the 27th of April because I want to hopefully have all of my goals met for the stitch counts that I wanted to get to in May so that I have time to start a new project at the end of the month. So that's my carrot to kind of push me on to complete the tasks I've set for myself. So I had outlined 13 projects that I wanted to put 1,000 stitches each into. And I'm pleased to say that I'm definitely making progress on that. You saw some of them last time, and so we're going to talk about what I have gotten completed, what I'm working on, and then what I have left before I can allow myself to have this new start. So the first project that I got another 1,000 stitches in was my Desert Mandala. My goal for this one is basically to finish from here to here all the way across. So I am done down to here, I believe on both sides. I need to backstitch this feather, but the upper vignette here is done. And I got a lot of progress done on this end of things. The butterfly was already finished, and most of the jackrabbit was done. I finished the backstitching there. I put in this cactus and this flowering cactus, as well as the specialty stitches for those, and got started on this cactus. I need to do the floral specialty stitches on this cactus motif and add this feather. So then that little vignette will be done, and I just would need to bring down the border to that side. This side, I have started on this feather, which I need to finish, and like I said, I need to finish backstitching those, and I need to do the whole vignette. So I have a ways to go on this one, but I did put 1,000 stitches into it. Let's see if I can bring that jackrabbit a little closer. There he is. Really fun to stitch on. I have so enjoyed working on this. Yeah, and so feeling like I'm making good progress on this. This will be out again. I'm not sure if this is out in June, but I know it will be out in July because this was a birthday start and I like to work on it in July. It's just kind of a fun project to work on then. So you'll see that one again. And I also put another 1,000 stitches in on Once Upon a Fairy Tale. So I worked on all of these dark parts here. And so I'm working on this second page of that. If you can't tell from the size, this is the supersize max color version. Artwork is by Amy Stewart, and it's charted by Heaven and Earth Designs. I have met my year goal on this. I have finished that first page, which was where I wanted to be on that. But this one will come out a lot more this year because I am at about 10,000 stitches on it, and I am trying to get to 20 for the full coverage Fanatics 20K in 2020. Challenge where we're trying to do 20,000 stitches in a single project. It's also really handy because there's tons and tons of like challenge prompts it meets because it's got all kinds of crazy stuff in it. So you will definitely see that one out again, although not in May. So we're at a stopping point on that for this month. Then I worked on Winter's Encounter, which is another full coverage project. This is the mini version with artwork by Laura Prindle. And I have again met my year goal, which was a page finish on this one, but have continued to work on it. And I added pretty much all of this gray portion, which is the horse's shoulder and the front leg here. And then there's some of his mane that comes down here. So I am done these three pages. I have a partial page down here to finish and one here. And then I think there's two and a bit pages going that way. But this one is now at the just over the 30% mark, thanks to Pattern Keepers Info. So just, I love this one. It's one of my favorites to work on. I love the horse's eye. So that's where we are on that. So again, that had 1,000 stitches put in it and will not be out again this month. I have it, I think, slated in for maybe one other challenge later on this year, but other than just working away on it when I have time, no specific goals for that one. I then got through 1,000 stitches on the Drawn Threads Welcome Spring. This is the last one of the four of these that I have to do. I've gotten the fall, winter, and summer ones done. So spring is all I have left. And I'm stitching this on a 28 count antique white Monaco. I'm using the hand-dyed threads from Color and Cotton. And here is where this one is. So I have completed this letter and the bunny and this and the sea. Okay, so the first four letters are completely done, and so I have the OME to finish on this one, and finishing this is a goal for this year. So, love this kind of tealy blue from Color and Cotton and how it looks with those climbing roses. This was a variegated thread called Candyland, so that's just one thread, but it worked out almost perfectly to switch from that pale blue up to that darker rose color, and then it, I thought, went really nicely with the color conversion I had done for the pink roses. So this will be out again this year, but not this month. Currently, 1,000 stitches in that one, so checked that off the list. Next, this is the November wordplay from Brenda Gervais and with Thy Needle and Thread. I am working this on, I believe it's a 32 count, just plain linen that was a cutoff piece from another project I did last year. And I am converting this all to color and cotton. Put something behind it because it's kind of see-through. I am very close to having this one done. I have a big pumpkin to finish up here. And a couple of the smaller motifs, like I have to put the head on the pilgrim lady, and there's a pilgrim dude I have to finish up here. But this one is pretty close to being done. I feel like maybe another 800 stitches or so, another couple of days time on it, and I could have that pretty easily finished up. But this is at the stopping point for mania purposes. But you will definitely see that one out again this year because I would like to get that one finished. My goal is to have had all of the word plays finished, and I have four left. I have June and May, which I showed you, I think, last video. And then I have November and December, which you're about to see, to finish up. And one thing that's been really nice about how I broke my mania plans down was that I feel like I've gotten a lot of these projects close enough that I can get a finish on them fairly quickly. Maybe June, July, August, get the smaller ones finished up and then concentrate on the few bigger things like that top portion of the desert mandala to get finished and actually make progress on those. Let me show you this next one here. This is the December wordplay, as you might guess. And I am stitching this on, I think it's a 32 count. I have it in here somewhere. 32 count Valor from Picture This Plus. And so it's gonna show a little bit grayer here, I think. It's actually kind of a sage green linen. And again, converting everything to color and cotton, hand-dyed floss, and that's where I am on that. I had literally like 12 stitches of his body done to start this. So this is about 700 stitches into it. So I have a little bit more work to finish on this one, but I'm getting there. So it will get a little bit more love before it goes away to come back out later this year. So that is what I have been working on for my mania currently. The other thing that I have on the go right now but did not bring up is another Haid, which is A Long Winter's Nap. It's on my frame right now, so I didn't bother to bring it. And I'm maybe halfway through that 1,000. So for the things that I have left, I have Christmas Morning Pets, which is a Dimensions Gold Petite Kit. I have to work on that. I have 1,000 stitches that I want to put into Which Way, and I have 1,000 stitches to put into my Celtic Wheel. So I'm hoping to at least get to most of those. Let me back up. If I get done the things that I'm currently working on plus what I've shown you, that will get me to the 10,000 stitches mark. And I'm going to the 13,000 stitches mark. So I have those last three projects to work on. And I'm hoping to at least get going on one, if not two of those this weekend. So I feel like I'm in pretty good shape to get those goals met and then to actually cast on, to start my new start, which I've earmarked as Huckleberry Farm. And I've pulled floss and I've pulled fabric for that. Ran those by Kim over at Spartan Stitcher, who thought they looked good. And so I will show you those next time, because hopefully I will be fairly close to having my goals met and be ready to start that project to close out the end of May. We'll see. I think that's going to be it for me today. Like I said, I am trying to keep this a little bit shorter, and we're already at 35 minutes. So I am going to try to be back, sometime in the next 10 days before Memorial Day holiday here in the United States, and just update you guys with what I've been working on. And like I said, hopefully I'll be pretty close to having a bunch of finishes on things, or, you know, having met my goals. And then we can talk about some plans for June, which I'm very excited for as well, because I've got a few things on tap that I'm really looking forward to. So links as usual below. As always, thank you so much for your comments and for watching, and thumbs up and hearts and all those good things. I hope you are all staying well. I'm thinking of each and every one of you. And until I talk to you next time, everybody stay safe, stay well. Bye for now.